Welcome to City Fair 2020, Europe's B2B networking workshop for destinations, organised by ETOA, the European Tourism Association, in partnership with European Cities Marketing. This year's City Fair will be more important than ever as we look forward to 2021 and beyond. The workshop will offer one of the first occasions to have open and productive conversations about client needs and their demands for new and adaptive travel product as we enter recovery. 2020 is an exceptional year, and at ETOA we've been hard at work to respond to the changing circumstances, finding a solution to best serve the needs of the industry and our members. A live, in-person event would not have been practical this summer. Instead, we will now deliver our tried and tested B2B networking workshop online. City Fair 2020 will provide over 5,000 high-quality meetings between European tourism suppliers and those taking their product to market. A perfect opportunity to reconnect with existing contacts and meet new leads, discovering new ways to work together to ensure a successful and sustainable recovery. The registration and appointment matching system are not changing. As usual, we'll ask you to select and rank your counterparts based on your preferences. We'll then use this data to create dedicated appointment schedules. Of the day of the event, rather than attending in person, all you will need to do is log on to our online portal and participate in your meetings via video link. Once the day's sessions have begun, and again exactly like a typical ETOA workshop, your meetings will run according to schedule. Our system will log you into the next meeting automatically. Sign up today and join your industry colleagues in this cost-effective way to help stimulate the recovery of the European tourism industry. Select, connect and meet. Share your priorities and we can make the most of these very real opportunities on offer in 2021 and beyond.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. My name is Tim Fairhurst from ETOA. Welcome to this morning's webinar. And today we are focusing on diversity in European tourism. And we're joined by specialists from four regions. I can see three of them. One, I believe, is still joining. And just to go from west to east, we have Filipe Pinto from center of Portugal, Alberto Bosque from Castilla and León, and Anne-Sophie Rabreaud from Atlantic Loire. So perhaps if you just quickly want to say hello, guys, and then I'll say some introductory remarks. Filipe.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm Filipe Pinto from the center of Portugal. Hope you enjoy.
Alberto.
Hi, it's Alberto Bosque speaking from Castilla León Tourism Board. It's a pleasure meeting you, and thank you to ETOA for the opportunity.
Anne-Sophie.
Bonjour, Anne-Sophie from Atlantic Loire Valley Tourism Board in France. Happy to be here with you and to share some insights today.
Thank you very much. So hopefully we will have a colleague from Puglia joining us. So I'll just keep an eye out on the chat. Sometimes there are technical glitches. So the reason why we organized this event today is really to remind all of us that even though tourism is in a tough place right now, we recognize fully that lots of businesses are struggling. The government support mechanisms are straining to look after the ecosystem because there is no demand. We are just turning the corner. This webinar will be about the recovery. We've got specialists from regions who perhaps do not see so many visitors as some of the most visited cities of Europe, but have nevertheless got an amazing offer to share. And as to begin with, we are focusing on domestic tourism, and then tourism from neighboring markets. It's very interesting for all of us to learn what's going on in these perhaps less frequented regions, which have got an extraordinary offer, and really animate what Europe's diverse offer is. So without any further comment from me, I'm going to invite our panelists to make their initial presentations just to set the scene, and then the conversation will continue. For all of our attendees, and I can see the numbers are slowly creeping up, please do note that there is an opportunity to enter some questions by text. So do use that. I can see a hello from Switzerland from Roberto. Hello to you. Please do add your questions there and we'll come to those during the webinar. We will also be asking you some questions to participate in as a poll in the next 10 or 15 minutes. So keep an eye out for those and those will help the conversations move along. So welcome all, over to you, Filipe.
Well, thank you, Tim.
I think we're just trying to switch the control from Philip's screen. Here we go. Philip, over to you.
Here we go. So thank you for joining us. So I'm representing the center of Portugal. Sorry, I can't change the slide. Okay. So this is our region, the center of Portugal. We are the largest region inside in Portugal, inland Portugal, and in the country. And we are between Lisbon and Porto, as you can see on the map. We have 270 kilometers of border with Spain and about the same as coastline. Therefore, this makes us a very diversified region, and we have different offers from the ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, to the inland mountains. The largest mountain range in Portugal is also in our region, which is the Estrela Mountain with 2,000 meters high. So during this time, during this pandemic, we had two different approaches to deal with what was going on. So at the first time, we launched an online diary, an online journal, which was mainly for our hotels and partners, so they could follow up with everything that was going on. This was launched on the 6th of April, and it was called Better Than Z. So the idea was to have daily communications to everyone of the sector of tourism, so they could keep up to the government's plans and to what the region was doing, and so they could all share also the insights. We had daily communications to all of them, and we also followed closely the Turismo Portugal trade talks, which was focused on different markets. So the first one was on 17th of April. It was about the Spanish market, and the next one is going to be on the 12th of July, of June, sorry, about Czech Republic. So if I'm able to click here, it should open. Let me try to open the website. So this is our first phase of the program, and the idea was to keep up good news, a bit of science, cultural information, economic and legislation. So all this was updated daily. Yesterday's was dedicated to the Polish market, so we have a specific market by day, and it was our way to communicate to everyone what was going on throughout the world. And then this passes to the next phase, to the next stage, which is actually starting now. So our next second step, we're launching a website thing called Embrace You Soon. This is our contact, our form to get in contact with everyone and to understand what's going on. So if I can just also go on the website, on the Embrace You Soon website. So here we are. This is our new website. And this is us working very closely with the Tourism of Portugal delegations throughout the world. So our aim is to obviously promote, first of all, this clean and safe logo, which was introduced by the Tourism of Portugal. This was a way to put out to everyone that was a safe country to travel to. And this wasn't made out of the blue. So our country has, since 2006, followed the HACCP norms, and which is very closely monitored to the Economic Security Authority. That's why we were a country were able to implement the safety very fast and to all units. So we are also launching this website. The next week, we're going to update it. And we're going to have daily updates. Here you'll be able to see all the regions, all the places I have a clean and safe logo inside our region. And then we're going to have the different offers from nature with love to small towns and great towns to slow living. This is from here. We want to have podcasts So the podcast, we're going to invite journalists and opinion leaders to describe their experience about the center of Portugal. Then we'll have webinars as well with our tourism delegations, tour operators, which we'll invite, hotel businesses, and activities such as wine production, chefs, and small histories. So this is a way for us to invite everyone to share their experiences and also for hotels to promote themselves. Later on, we will also want to have an e-learning platform so everyone can learn a little bit more about the center of Portugal. This is just a short presentation of what we're doing. I'll now hand over back to Tim.
Filipe, thank you very much indeed for that. That gives a very good flavor of the kind of thing that's going on, both in terms of organization and product. Alberto, would you like to say what's been going on just the other side of the border in Spain, please?
Yeah, just the other side. We are neighbors. The Portuguese are more than neighbors. We are brothers. And we are setting this border. And in Castilla y León, you know, we have here on my back, you can see the map. This is one of the biggest regions in Europe. Consider that Castilla y León is even bigger than Portugal, for instance. So now I think that is, well, when we have a situation like this, anything is good. But at this situation, having a huge region with a low density of population, perhaps is a good opportunity for us. We can start with the first slide, if you don't mind, and you are going to be able to see where Castilla y León is. It's right in the center part of our country of Spain, between the Cantabric coast and Madrid. We are very well connected with the rest of Europe. Speaking about tourism from our neighbors, we are very well connected with the airports of Madrid. We have a very good connection by train. There's a first slide anyway, and there you are going to see where we are based. There are 9 provinces in our region, as you can see: Burgos, Palencia, León, Soria, Valladolid, Zamora, Ávila, Segovia, and Salamanca, 3 World Heritage Cities declared by UNESCO. We can start with the first slide, if you don't mind, but here we are. There are 94,000 square kilometers with a very low population. It means that we have only 27 inhabitants per square kilometer. And thinking about this possibility and this situation, I think that is a time for let's go rural, let's diversificate for looking for another areas, looking for another products, and I think that this region is great for this. We can go to the next slide now. And in Castilla y León, we are going to find this history, culture, heritage, nature, a lot of activities that could be done, walking tours, biking tours, so many things to be enjoyed. Here, for instance, we can see the wine that is one of our main products, and I think that wine tourism is going to be very accepted and is going to be successful for next year. We can go, Jeff, to the next slide, and we can take advantage of this situation. I think that it's time to change a little bit, to adapt. Adapt is more is a very good word at this time, I think. And I think that in Castilla y León there are plenty of things that you can take advantage of, and here we are to help you. We can go to the next slide. In fact, now it's time to work much more and to work united. It's time for cooperating the public sector and the private sector. We have always been here, my colleagues Anne-Sophie, Filipe, and so on, but now it's time to work even more with the private sector, with the travel agencies, tour operators, and so on. And this is the last slide. You can see that we have another seal, that is another stamp, that is safe tourism. It's the Portuguese model. In fact, Filipe was saying that they were pioneers, and it's true, and we are following in Spain. You know that there are several ways of being safe. We are confident and we are cautious, we are very, very careful with all of this health situation, but we are trying to help our companies, our hotels, our travel agencies, our local guides, and so on, to be safe for the tourists that are going to visit us. And this is our seal, Turismo de Confianza, Safe Tourism. And yeah, Castilla y León is ready for having all of you and for helping all of the professional sector. As I said, it's the most important time for that, helping each other, having cooperation and solidarity and trying to go through it.
Alberto, gracias. I think that message of collaboration and what does good public-private collaboration look like now, how we can work together in order to provide the sort of product our clients want, is absolutely where this discussion goes. Anne-Sophie, over to you.
So Atlantic Loire Valley, so we are located here in the western part of France, below Brittany, above Bordeaux, and we are along the Loire Valley, which is listed on the UNESCO World Heritage. And just to give you some of the pictures of what we can do and what you can see in our region. So as you can see, the Loire River, it's a mix of green and blue, so we are very into nature. And you have all the cultural heritage with the chateaus and the specificity of our region. This part of the Loire Valley that goes up to the Atlantic Ocean is that we have some chateaus that are quite intimate and where people still live in there. So today we are more in a confidential way of experiencing our destination and meeting with the people who've been living there for sometimes 400 centuries. So the same family. So you really have, when you come to our region, this interaction with the local people. So these are some of the pictures that you can see. So in terms of access that I forgot to mention, and let's go back to slide one. Nantes is our main city with our international airport, very well connected with Europe. And then in France, so you have the high-speed train that connects lots of cities. So in 55 minutes, you can be from Paris to, you can arrive in Le Mans, which is one of our main cities as well, known for the 24-hour car race. And then we also have the Atlantic coast, which, as you can see on the picture, is a way to breathe and to experience the wild landscapes and the nature. And this is where we really want to focus now and to show that you can have a French experience meeting with local people while having also this this atmosphere of being really outside and really breathing. And even in our cities, which are mid-sized range cities, you can definitely discover the cultural heritage and also the events that go on. For instance, in Nantes this summer, they always have summer art festival, which is called Le Voyage à Nantes, and which is definitely outside. So it's only outdoor exhibition. So this is what we try to highlight in terms of offer. And then, regarding the crisis, so what we've done is that obviously we've been very close to our local suppliers and connected also with the French government that has implemented new rules and in terms of safety, because this is where we go first. And I agreed with my colleagues in terms of solidarity. We definitely need to work on together to go over this current crisis. So,
fantastic, thank you. All of these pictures make all of us keen to somehow find a way of exploring and getting out into Europe again. I just wanted to draw attention to one thing you said about interaction with locals, and I think that was implicit in a lot of what Filipe and Alberto said, that the sorts of experiences on offer do provide an opportunity to interact with the community. So perhaps that's something we can explore as our conversation continues. Just looking at some of the questions we have, I can see that people are very interested about the potential for tourists from overseas, and I'm quoting from a question from Roberta. They may feel reluctant to travel because of the fear of being stuck abroad. If a sudden spike in corona cases will happen, Is there any news about reopening Europe for overseas, USA, Australia? I think that's a little bit outside the scope of this webinar, but it's a chance just to draw your attention to what's on our website, Robertus. We do have lots of information about that. Our general understanding is that the external Schengen borders, that's probably not going to see widespread opening until September, but internally within Schengen, we're very hopeful the beginning of July we'll see widespread relaxation. But again, more information on the website. I think the long haul markets in particular, we will have buyers on this webinar who are interested in product to be developed for 2021 and beyond. And certainly the safety, what happens when you get here and whether or not people are going to want different sorts of product is certainly something that's going to be part of our discussion today. So what I'm going to do now, and this is for our audience interaction, I'm going to launch a poll which will take as a starting point that, as we've just heard, we're focusing on domestic demand at the moment. At the moment, we think that we're going to get visitors from our locality, our own cities, our neighboring regions, the country next door. So what does that actually mean? So the poll is now being launched. And it says, focus on domestic demand will develop more community-friendly tourism in Europe. And our attendees are now welcome to submit their answers. At the moment, we've got quite a few votes. So I'll keep that open for a couple of minutes. The reason for asking this question is that in 2019, the big topic was overtourism. One of the aspects of overtourism wasn't particularly just overcrowding or the pressure of numbers, also a social element to it. Is it that tourism is accepted? Is it valuable? Is it welcome by the host community? So one of the observations that we have about tourism generally is that we, as the travel industry, sell what domestic demand has supported all this time. The reason why people go to visit London is that people in the UK like theatre, like shopping, all of these things are there. It's not only foreign money that supports it, although we really are missing it. So I think the question is, whether you think there will be more community-friendly tourism in the sense that the community welcomes it, it's an opportunity, as Anne-Sophie said, to interact a bit more. So tourism is something that participates a little bit more in the life of a community. So I'm going to close the poll quite soon, but the certainly the majority of people are either saying agree or strongly agree. That's over 80% in that camp. So I'm going to close the poll now. I'll give it another 10 seconds just to give a few more people a chance to vote. And only 2% of people disagree that domestic demand will catalyze more community-friendly tourism in Europe. So I'd like to invite our panelists to comment on that. How do you think tourism will develop in a way that the host community will welcome and participate in? So perhaps Alberto, would you have any reflections on that in terms of how will tourism develop in a way that the people who live in your very large but very lightly populated area, is a lot of tourists something that the community is going to welcome, and are they planning for that?
Okay, locals, I think that is a key word actually for so many reasons. One of the reasons is because we know that that people can visit our destinations. It could be, let's say, dangerous in some way, because the things in healthy terms are going well, and it seems that we are going to solve the situation very, very soon. But there could be some people that could think that people that are going to visit us could be harmful in some way. So this is something that we have to consider. But I think that this huge region that, as you were mentioning, and this thing of let's go rural could be something good for us. And this is something that we, from the public sector, we have to work with. Letting see the people that tourism is not bad at all, and we can handle the situation. It's like the situation of living near the crocodiles. You have to handle it. You have to know that there is a situation, and we have to take care of it, and taking care of the people, the local people, that could we could live with this situation and with the people that are going to visit us. And the only thing is to take care and follow the rules, follow the protocols, and anything is going to happen. And afterwards, the locals is a key word too, because we think that we have to attract the people from the neighbor cities and the neighbor regions and so on, but we can work also with the local people in our regions, and we could develop in some way the tourism, the inside tourism, so the tourism for the people of the very same city. Sometimes there are people of the city that didn't visit never the museum on the right center of the city, and this is something that we have to handle this situation, and to invite our local people to visit our region and our cities and so on, also because they are ambassadors of ourselves. So this is something that I think that we have to work a lot with the locals. And afterwards, with this local convivence that Anne-Sophie was mentioning before, I think that is very good that from the public sector, we do something in order to invite everyone to meet the locals. This is something that always happens, and this is a good way of doing tourism, I think, because sometimes we go to a country and we come back and we never met anyone from this country. We only spoke to the waiters and to the person from the lobby and from the reception desk or whatever. But I think that at this time, we can insist on this idea of meeting the locals and helping with the private sector in order to help them to organize activities for meeting the locals. And right now with this situation, forever, perhaps this situation that we had could change in a good way in some aspects of the tourism. So this is something that we don't have to be lazy and on the public sector, and we have to work on the local aspect.
That's very interesting. And I think the remark you made about making that available to the private sector, because it's a very hard thing for the private sector to organize themselves. You know, how do you arrange an activity which does not feel very synthetic and very contrived, that really feels like a genuine connection with local people? And if that's something that regions are able to focus on and create more product, for sure demand will follow. Just some news, our colleague Alfredo from Puglia has been able to join us, though the video is not working well. So what we'll do is we'll go through this round of questions and to talk about community tourism, and then I'll invite Alfredo to give a quick presentation about Puglia, and maybe he will like to add some reflections on the community aspects of tourism as well. So Filipe, would you like to add any comments about how you think tourism is going to develop in a way that sort of is participatory as far as the community goes and gives more connection between visitors and the locals?
Well, yeah, definitely. I think you touched in a crucial point there, Tim, which is are the countries ready? Are the countries prepared to receive people? And now that is going to influence and it's going to impact with the locals. We have some examples of things that are going on that reflects exactly that. So firstly, obviously, there's going to be a very digitalized concern. So things are going to move more to digitalize. And for example, in the city of Aveiro, in our region, by the sea, there's a project being developed in linked with Via Verde, which is the national company, the pioneer company of the highway toll system, which allows you to park the car within the city contactless by our car tracker, let's say. So small things like this will make a huge difference in the community, because people benefit from this this new technology that's being prepared to deal with the crisis and to welcome tourists in a safe way. Also, for example, in the same city, the festivals which are very strong in the summer in Iberian Peninsula and in the southern countries, our summer it's always lively activities all the time. And the cities have to adapt, especially smaller cities. And what is, for example, one example that we have is an international festival. What the city is doing is they're inviting local artists instead of foreign artists. So that's also a way to promote the communities instead of and promoting your locals. And they're organizing the shows and the tiling paintings, for example. So let's say you have to previously book your seat, and they're spread out. So instead of being just one day of festival or 2 days as normal, they'll spread out it more. So there's more people can go in a safer way. And that also has an impact in the community. So in this way, we also help combat overcrowding tourism, which some cities are already feeling, even though in our small regions, the cities are small. So in a great weekend, let's say a sunny weekend, some cities close to Spain, because of the proximity, they might be full of Spanish tourists. And
that's great.
That's good. That's very good. But then again, it might lead to the overcrowding that sometimes might happen. And these new strategies and technology, I think they're crucial. And also projects like the mobility, for example, bicycling, cycling, and cycling paths are being developed more and more. So we do have a very strong offer of cycling through the interior of the country to the mountains or by the coast. We have the Atlantic Road, for example, that goes 60 kilometers along our coast, which is a beautiful scenery. And now municipalities are developing this alternative more and more. And soon we'll be able to link all our region with cycling paths, which is also a great option for locals, which gives them a more a wider offer. So I think from this, locals can benefit on the great technology and on the great development that will happen to try and combat the crisis and then try and make everything safe for tourism.
Thank you very much, Filipe. And I think what you're illustrating there is there's some possibility for investment. So infrastructure, which is good news for the local population, new bike paths and so on, that could well be something that can be used by the visitor economy as well. So are there opportunities to benefit both rather than just favoring one or the other? Thank you very much. Anne-Sophie, any remarks on this topic?
Yeah, actually, while I agree with Filipe on the fact that digitalization has become has increased in our life and has been an asset for tourism, I also think that this crisis has proven that we need to be more focused on human beings. I mean, I guess personally, the first thing I wanted to do when the quarantine was over was to come back to the office and to meet with my colleagues and to interact with my families. So this is where I guess that we as a destination which is lucky not to be overcrowded have something to do with that. For instance, communities who are interested in wine. In our region, we have in the Loire Valley, we have wineries that are specific in the way that they are mostly family run and small companies. So this is where the communities which are interested in, for instance, wine tourism could come and get this interaction and meet with the locals. And us as a public institution, but also working with our local suppliers, we are here to help travel operators to find the right suppliers that will be able to host the groups that they have to meet in order to meet with the communities. In fact, during this since the crisis started, we've had lots of more and more interest from tour operators that are looking for products that they can offer to their clients, but products niche products or products that are unknown to the other. So this is where as local authority, we know all these secret addresses where people are know how to welcome tourists, and obviously we are also helping them making sure that they comply with the safety and security measures. But this is where I guess we can also play a role, helping you travel operators, getting in touch with those local and local suppliers who are really avid to meet with and to welcome the visitors.
Thank you, Anne-Sophie. And actually, just on the offer, I see a question from Maria Engblom, who is interested to find out more hotels. So she's definitely got some groups, but finds that the hotel offer not quite enough for some of the, quite a lot of small hotels. So I think maybe there's an opportunity there to promote the hotels which are capable of accepting groups. Have you got any remarks on just the general demographic of the hotel supply? And is this a question that you come across?
Well, actually, yes, and especially along the Loire Valley, we usually have some group demands for that. The thing is, along the Loire Valley, we have lots of typical hotels that are more family run or used to be former chateaus where people can obviously now be hosted for the night. So there would be more intimate, but we also have in different cities such as Angers, Saumur, and also Nantes, obviously all the main hotel chains where we can accommodate more and more people. And as I guess everywhere, hotels are reopening step by step, so it's quite encouraging. So if the person has specific question, then I'll be happy to answer her and to give her some insight.
Super, thank you very much. We'll connect you after this session. We've only got 20-25 minutes to run, and I'm very aware that we've got an extremely patient Alfredo in the wings from Puglia. So what we're going to do now is we're going to give you a map of Puglia just to make you think of all that gorgeous sea and sun down there, and invite him to say a few remarks about what's going on in Puglia. Alfredo, over to you and welcome.
Hi, Tim, and hi to everybody. I hope you can hear me. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. Thank you. And first of all, thanks for the invitation. I take care of the tourist board of Puglia and I'm the marketing manager, so I mostly work on the business-to-business activity. Here you have a small illustrated map of what's the offer of our destination. We are actually the heel of the boot of Italy, and we are a very Mediterranean and authentic destination in the south of Italy. The good news is that at the moment, the south of Italy, it's okay. Everything is open, all the bar, restaurants, and most of the hotels are reopening again. The small ones are already open. The medium are opening in a week or 10 days. So the situation is getting normal and safe again. What we will not have this summer are only the big events, big gathering, but probably it's okay to have a more soft summer, you know. And we were talking about what's happening in these days, and I live my life between Puglia and Rome, and look at our destination like Rome or Puglia that are almost empty and only with local people, make you think about number of tourism that sometimes probably too many people don't make, they do make places not so nice, you know. So this time has to make us reflect on the numbers of tourism. Anyway, let's go back on the destination. And Puglia, we have 800 kilometers of coastline, 800 kilometers of beautiful coastline with sandy beach, cliffs, rocky areas, marine reserve where you can go diving or hiking on the coast. Then we also have five-star luxury property with private beach, so we really have all different kind of offer and landscape on the coastline. Puglia has four UNESCO sites. One is the Trulli of Albero Bello. Our cone-shaped house is made out of stone. You can see them in the middle of this small map. Then we have Castel del Monte, a little bit northern. It's a castle that was built by the German Emperor Frederick II. Then we keep going north in the National Park of Gargano, where we have the sanctuary of Monte Sant'Angelo. It's a pilgrimage site since thousands of years, and the pristine forest called the Foresta Umbra in the center of the Gargano National Park. As I told you before, we have two national parks. One is the Promontory on the north, that is Gargano, and the other one is Altamurgia National Park. In both parks, you can go hiking, biking, and enjoy the nature, Mediterranean nature. They're really beautiful places. We have different marine reserves, amazing for diving, really. The two main airports to fly into Puglia are Bari and Brindisi. And then I had yesterday some really good news from our airport organization. And by the end of June, early July, most of the European cities will be connected to Puglia again, and the will start again. So this is a very good news for European tourism. We have some amazing properties and experience that you can do in Puglia, and I would like to underline our farmhouse is converted into hotels. They are called masserie, and they do host people and offer like a local farming experience. Some are bed and breakfast, some are 3-4 stars, and some are 5-star luxury that even hosted the people like Madonna and Justin Timberlake. So we really have a wide offer, you know. Another character of Puglia are our olive trees. We have millions of thousand year olive trees. Some of them are really huge, huge. They look like baobab in Africa sometimes, you know. You should look at them, really amazing one. We have a really extraordinary cuisine, and you can find local osterie to Michelin star chef. Some of our main food are our homemade pasta that is called the orecchiette, small here, and you can try to do it on the street, and most of our offer will invite you to try to make our local pasta. Our main street food is called focaccia, and you can find it in every bakery, and you will see local people eating that on the street. Anyway, let's go back on the local people. When people travel to Puglia and many places, I think that one of the best things is that our local people are really natural, hospitable people, and they are all passionate about our land, you know, and probably because we live at the border, you know, living on the seashore means living at the border. You can just jump on a boat and be in Greece, in Croatia, in Montenegro. So we are connected to the world Mediterranean since always. And so this is what make local people hospitable. And so this is one of the best part of traveling in Puglia. We don't have one main thing in Puglia. We have our offer is spread out all over the region with different things, but one of the main things is definitely the local people to meet. Thank you, and I'm hoping to any question.
That was again, it's a curious exercise in interest and envy, because I'm hearing about all of those things which are right now quite difficult, but it's very encouraging to hear that by the end of the month we expect airlift internally within Europe to develop. And I think that the sense that there's a very diverse offer there is really a prompt for people to research further. I do want to return to this idea of what the B2B offer is. I think it's very clear, and we all understand and appreciate that within the less populated parts of Europe, there are wonderful experiences for family groups, individuals, small groups. I think this question of what is possible to do for groups of 20, 30 or more people, perhaps on a day excursion from a larger city. There's a big opportunity, there's a big interest and a big demand there. So if we can help catalyze a conversation about new offer in that area, which is scalable, that people can book in the future, I think we'll see a lot of interest from our buyers. Seeing one or two questions coming in. Interesting one from Oscar. Concerning digitalization, do you think gamification will be part of the future? So will use of online technology be something your region looks at, perhaps to train people who are selling and promote knowledge about your region? So in terms of digital, is that being used as a way of talking to the travel trade, the people who are selling your region, in order to educate them? So if any of you have got any comments on that, please just put your finger up, or Alfredo, just jump in. So maybe spend a minute or two on that, and then we'll go to the next poll. So, Filipe.
Yeah, definitely. As I started the presentation with our latest Embrace You Soon website, that's exactly it. So what we aim is to give both side of views in one single website. So we aim to show to the public into three separate points: the slow living, the nature, and the small town, great towns, which we believe it will be the greatest points, the hits for 2020 and 2021, which is also part of our strategy already for next year. And also with the podcasts, and the webinars and e-learning that we'll promote, that's exactly it. We want to give people information, travel operators, inviting hotels to speak directly on the website, and inviting people that we've invited to our destination through fam and press trips that we did a lot, but now came to a halt, to give their insights, how they felt in our destination, what they saw, and how they see it from their eyes, so not just us, not just us promoting. And that's exactly it, where we're going and where we believe the world will go to and what we're trying to do and to achieve. So if you stay tuned to our Embrace You Soon website, in the next weeks you'll have more updates.
Thank you, Philip. Alberto and Sophie, anything to add around just different ways of promoting and raising awareness in the market using digital tools?
Well, actually, on our side, so we do not currently have digital tools or like Filipe can just mention. But yeah, what we do is that we've developed online webinars to keep in touch with our contacts. But in terms of offers, I would say that yeah, during the crisis, we've seen that more and more museums have gone virtual, and it's been really proven to be very efficient. And we also have, yeah, in terms of gamification, more and more of our cultural sites incorporating those gamifications and directed to either families or senior people. I'm thinking about a 1,000-year-old abbey where you have iPads where you can recreate the way the abbey was back in the time using colors and etc. to make it more fun in terms of interacting with the visitors. So yeah, we have more and more of these, and we have escape games, etc., that are developing as well using digital digitalization.
That's great. And a lot of virtual tools can be used to build expectation and maintain excitement in the period between booking and actual departure as well. So I think great to see some developments there. So we're going to have another poll soon. What I'll first do is just show you the final results for the poll we asked earlier as to whether or not domestic demand was going to drive what we call more community-friendly tourism. So here are the results of that poll. So we see that 83% either strongly agree or agree that domestic demand will develop more community-friendly tourism in Europe. And I think the challenge for all of us in the industry is the degree to which there's an offer available B2B as well as for individuals. So we're going to move to the next poll. I'll just hide those results. And the next poll is just looking further ahead. We've been focusing on domestic tourism. What is going to be happening with product development for long haul? So the next question is coming up now. Long-haul tourism to Europe will diversify to more destinations. And the reasons for that could be varied. Some of that could be people are looking for what they perceive to be a safer experience because they're in more open rural environments rather than cities. Although it's worth saying that European cities have probably never been this quiet, so it's a very good time to visit the cities too. It may be that regions and destinations are trying very hard with particular origin markets to come up with an offer and a welcome that appeals. So the question is, long-haul tourism to Europe will diversify to more destinations. It will become more spread out. And that will obviously support some of the ambition to diversify the benefit of tourism in a socioeconomic way as well. This was definitely on the agenda before the crisis came along. And perhaps in the 10 minutes or so we have remaining in this webinar, we can explore where we think product development is going, maybe elaborate on what Alberto was talking about with regard to public-private collaboration in order that we can develop a new offer and spread the business around in a way that really works for clients and the people who can sell Europe around the world and also is going to work for the local community. So only about a third of you have voted, so this needs to be a lively democracy. So I'd encourage everyone to jump in. Please have an opinion, and then we will have a discussion for the next 8 or 9 minutes or so in order to see. And I can see already that either agree or strongly agree is around about 80% again. So That's interesting. Our audience thinks that long-haul tourism will diversify. Now, that is a stronger indication than we were hearing when we were asking a similar question in April. So perhaps that's around perceptions of safety. Perhaps it's around opportunity, because we've heard such creative ideas of what the people can do in perhaps the lesser known regions. So I'm going to close the poll now and share those results. So there you go. 77% of people think that long haul tourism will diversify to more destinations. A reasonably significant minority disagree with that. And it's certainly the case that what is famous and well known in Europe will remain famous and well known as recovery progresses. But I think this is a very strong encouragement for our colleagues in the DMO community throughout Europe to really think about developing a product that will work for the travel trade. So any reflections from our panelists on those results? Alberto, over to you.
Okay, the question was long-haul tourism, and I think that is even bigger with the short-haul. So I think that it's clear that we are going to diversify the tourism for visiting another destination. And for we are going to diversify the tourism for new products. And that's also something that we have to do from the public sector. We are people are going to visit new places, and they are going to be interested in new things. I'm going to do an example, because there's a key word that I think that we have to handle, that is the incoming tour operators. We are thinking about, and we are saying some things about visiting new places and doing new things, but what do I have to do for visiting new places in some place, in some region or whatever? I'm going to make an example, not about Castilla y León, but about Puglia, for instance, with Alfredo permission. Ostuni is a great place, he didn't mention it, and I was lucky to visit one very special place that was La Donna di Ostuni. This is a very special place where I can see, I could admire something that is very difficult to be visited. And I was lucky enough to visit it because an incoming tour operator, and that's the key word that I wanted to mention. Our work is helping the private sector, as Anne-Sophie was mentioning, and how can we do it? Putting the people in touch with our incoming tour operators. An incoming tour operator is something very important right now, before, and right now is even more, because they are going to be able to identify the best places and the best things to do and the new products that we can offer to the clientele, to everyone. So the answer is yes, we are going to visit new places for long haul and short haul with the cooperation and with the assistance of the incoming tour operators, and not only new places but also new products. We were talking about wine, we were talking about biking, hiking or whatever. There are plenty of things to do in our four regions that we are here today. There are plenty of things to do in every province, in every city, and there are very good professionals in our regions that could identify those places. You were talking about the hotels that Oscar was having this question about, the hotels that are open right now. It's not very easy to find all of the hotels that are right now, but if you are looking for, if you are working with an incoming tour operator, he's going to be able to identify not only the open hotels right now, but the best hotels for every option and every necessity. So our work is putting you in touch with the incoming tour operators and helping them to work even better.
Thank you, Alberto, for mentioning Ostuni. Really kind from you. I completely agree with Alberto. If I can go on, and the key success and factor for Puglia Promozione, the tourist board, was to create a community with our offer, with our DMC, with our property, with all the companies that work with the international incoming tour operator. So this is working out very good for us, and we really work like a community. Whenever we are in a workshop, in a fair or an event overseas, we are always together, the tourist board with the private sector. And this is really important. I really completely agree with Alberto.
Thank you. Alfredo, it's a great remark. Apologies, I was muted earlier because I had a cough, which I didn't want to share with everyone. I don't think it's COVID. But just on hotel availability, we certainly heard from colleagues yesterday in Andalusia that now they're in phase three About 40% of hotels in Seville now open. But I think Alberto's point about how do you know which hotels are open, how we get that information to the market is going to be a catalyst for development. But Alfredo, thank you very much for your remark there. We've got 2 or 3 minutes left. Anne-Sophie or Filipe, any remarks about, you know, whether to Alberto's point that actually everything will diversify, not just long haul, but if you've got any particular remarks about how you're addressing the long haul market or how you think that will behave, that'd be very welcome.
Yeah, I'll jump in. So yeah, I totally agree with Alberto and Alfredo regarding the added value of the incoming tour operator that we know the secret places. And regarding the long haul market, I also strongly believe in the fact that yeah, they will develop to different regions. Actually, we've already seen that before the crisis came up. Let's take an example like the Chinese market. Obviously, when they come to France, they have to go to Paris, that's for sure, which is the main point of arrival. But then after seeing and discovering the must do or must sees in France, now we also have increases in demands from those long-haul markets who are looking for more authenticity and more rural experiences. Or because you know when you travel that when you go to a city, you have lots of experiences, a capital city, but usually it's not necessarily the way you can feel really the country. So we already saw an increase in especially repeaters from long-haul markets who first came to Europe and did and visited the must-sees and now want to come back and get a different experience, meeting more like the local, the real people, I would say, and getting more a real French experience, living like the French way of life. So definitely, we really hope we are really positive about long-haul market, but obviously not for now because we are all dependent of airline connections. And to finish with this, we are our strategy. So we basically definitely focused on the domestic market this first semester. On the second semester, we'll start again with the European market, and we will also take part to the London City Fair because for us connecting with the travel operators is key. Sure. And then next year we will expand. I mean, depending on how airline connections are going, but our idea is to expand to long haul market in 2021.
Thank you very much, Anne-Sophie, and just time for a couple of closing remarks. But I think now is the time that people are designing product for 2021 and 22. So certainly at City Fair, we will see a lot of buyers participating who are looking quite a long way ahead for their product. And I think all the ideas that you have and whether there are practical offers there is something that's going to be a really good discussion on the 20th of July. We've come to the end of our hour and we've really just opened the door to lots of interesting discussion. I would like to thank our excellent panelists for just giving us a flavor of your wonderful regions, the diversity that is in there, and also your very sort of positive approach to collaborating public, private, in order that we can develop tourism that's going to make sense for you and is going to provide lots of interesting offer for clients worldwide. So again, from west to east, thank you, Filipe. Thank you, Alberto. Thank you very much, Anne-Sophie and Alfredo in Puglia. Thank you so much for joining us. And to our audience, thank you very much. Stay safe. See you at the next webinar.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.